All right, thanks for joining us for this demonstration of the software-defined perimeter from SafeConnect SDP. I'm going to walk you through at a high level how you would get started. I'm going to use the cloud gateway in this example as it's the easiest approach to get oriented. We do have the private gateway as we describe it also. That is typically more for protecting on-premise resources, and the vast majority of our customers are currently using that gateway. So to get started, you can go to sdp.impulse.com. As you know, OPSWAT acquired Impulse recently, and the SDP domain has not yet been updated. Okay, we can click on create an account. I'm going to provide my account name. For now, I'm just going to use something as a throwaway here. I'm going to give my email address, which is also going to just be a throwaway. Obviously, I need to enter a password. I'm going to skip that, and then I'm going to let them know I'm not a robot. And we're ready to register. And I'm going to get an email sent to me for confirmation, so I'm going to be looking for that off screen here. And as soon as it arrives, I'm going to click through, and I'm going to then start to finish the rest of the registration process. Once I do get registered, you see this URL here is going to be my account or my tenancy. And I can get redirected back to that at any time, going to sdp.impulse.com or going back to the email. I have the email here. I'm going to click through and open that and bring that over onto the screen here for us to see the rest of the process. So you can see that the email that I clicked through on for confirmation has brought me back to the page where I just need to enter my password that I used when registering. Signing in. Okay, so now once I'm signed in, it's a bit of a wizard here that walks you through the process of setting up SDP. There is a deployment guide here that kind of also walks you through exactly what we're going through here today. But again, we'll take you through those steps that involve the private gateway. And so we encourage you to, once you're done watching this video, continue into that document. From a highest level, software-defined perimeter is about protecting applications. So in terms of configuration, the first thing is to tell the software-defined perimeter which applications to protect. Next, there's users involved, you know, which users are going to be permitted to access those applications, and the policies are what help govern which users can access the applications. And ultimately, we do also need to download the SDP client, as that is used to access those applications. We'll do that during the process of this demo so you can see the whole picture here. So next I'm going to go to the applications. When you do create your account, there is an example application that's primed in as a means to help easily test. If we do try to go access this application at this time, we'll find out that we won't have access. It's going to time out because the software-defined perimeter is doing its job. There's the cloud gateway in this case that's going to prevent access until we have the client installed and we're fully vetted and authenticated such that we can be trusted to access that application. So returning back to the example application definition, I'll open this quickly and show you what it takes to define an application. Out of the box here, we offer web application support or other. Other can be a resource or an application. So for example, you could protect a subnet or, you know, a legacy Windows file share. Obviously, you know, here you see that SSH and RDP are suggested. So there's a range of capabilities here with the software-defined perimeter. Here on a web application, we're providing the DNS, the fully qualified URL here to the resource. It could be an IP2, but typically for security reasons, you'll want to put in a DNS name there with the URL. And you can then specify ports that are going to be protected. And I should mention that if you take the other route and you're protecting a legacy app, you can not only do multiple ports, but you can do a range of IP addresses and a CIDR notation. There is the option to turn on the ICMP echo and permit pinging across here for diagnostic purposes. You can see that it's off by default. And then we provide an image that's going to help the user identify this application in their client little palette of applications that they see. So that's what's involved in creating an application within the software-defined perimeter. Next, we'll shift our focus to the users. So you can either define a connection to a SAML IDP, identity provider. So, you know, examples here in this dropdown, we have a guided sort of a wizard that walks through configuring the connection to the IDP. So the software-defined perimeter is acting as a service provider for SAML to allow users to get authenticated and to learn which groups they should be authorized into. So we'll back out of that for now. You can also define local users within the software-defined perimeter account. Here's the account that I created by registering. You see that it was automatically created and set as an administrator. We could add additional users here. And, you know, so you have that option either to go through SAML and leverage your organization's identity access management system or create them within the system here. So I'm going to go past users now to the policies. And as mentioned, these policies are going to be what controls whether a particular user or sets of users are able to access the applications we define. We see that we've got a default policy here as a result of just what the system does to help you get bootstrapped. The example application has my user that I registered with in it to facilitate me accessing it and experiencing this. But had we created other users, or if we had gone into SAML and configured things, this is where we would allow those single users or groups of users to access that application. Okay, and that's pretty much the high level configuration that the administrator would do. The next step would be to get set up to access, to provide access to end users. So here on this page, we're kind of repeat a little bit of what we've already done. You know, we've already tried to access that example web application, and that's what this link is for. So you've already seen that, you know, when we try to access it, it just times out. So that served its purpose. But, you know, so next step here would be to download the client. In this case, I'm on a Windows machine, so it offers me the Windows client. If I was on a Mac, it would offer to take me to the Mac App Store. We also have iOS and Android apps. So for now, I'll click download on this, let it come down. Brings up the installer. I'm going to click through. It's pretty straightforward installation. I need to change this account. I've used this previously, so it's got a different account name in here. And I need to enter the account name I gave when I signed up, and to just double check on that. If I come back up here, I'll see that, because sometimes there's confusion with customers. They'll enter an email address here rather than the name they gave for the account when they signed up. So it is just that same value that I gave when I was registering, not an email address. So I'm gonna finish the installation. And you can see that it's finished and it started the application. You can see here that it has the account name in the title bar here to let me know that I am on the right account. So OPSWAT SDP1 was my account name. I'm going to log in as that user that we created when I started. Let me see if I still have that on the clipboard. I don't. I'm going to go grab that, paste it in here, and get my password. And so what it's doing right now is it's creating a perimeter of one, a connection from my endpoint up to the gateway, using the fact that we're now seeing this example application means that it has finished that authentication and standing up that ability to connect. So that application that we previously tried to connect to here that didn't allow us to access will now load because we've done what's needed to get authenticated to the gateway. So the client has talked to the controller, asked for the permission, and the client was then given the destination of where that hidden application lives, given the right sort of secret handshake information to build the packets for a single packet authentication to flow over to the gateway and allow a successful connection. So the fact that we're seeing this page load is an indication that that has all worked as expected. So in summary, you've seen the SDP client work, able to access what was otherwise a darkened application that was hidden from us. We've walked through the steps to do the initial configuration, which involved which applications to protect, which users, either through SAML or natively within the SDP account, set up the policies, installed the client, went through the full procedure here to help you understand end-to-end how to protect an application with a software-defined perimeter. So that's it in a nutshell. So I encourage you, the next steps would be to use that guide that we mentioned in the start state here to finish deploying presumably an on-premise or self-hosted gateway. Thanks for your time. Bye.